Hello and welcome to The Big Picture. As part of the series on looking at India during the year 2014, we will today look at the Indian agricultural scenario and how it has fared. Indian agriculture has been a paradox for some time. While the production is going up and exports are growing, there is also a growing distress among the farmers. While the weather is obviously a factor, affected as the farmers are by cycles of drought and floods, policies regarding agriculture, investments in it, have also been a constant source of concern. With huge pressure from various sources to shift to GM crops, that is also an issue which remains unresolved. Agriculture, which accounts for 54.6% of total employment, however, has seen a rapid decline in number of cultivators. Soil fertility is a major issue. Water is another. Today, we will look at the year gone by, how agriculture has fared, and what can we expect in the coming year. To discuss this, are an eminent panel of experts. I have with me Sompal, former Union Minister for Agriculture, on the phone line from Chandigarh, Tajamul Haq, former Chairman, Commission for Agricultural Costs and Prices, Suman Sahai, Chairperson, Gene Campaign, Professor Sudhir Panwa, President, Kisan Jagriti Manch, and Gargi Parsai, Associate Editor of The Hindu. Welcome to all of you. Mr. Sompal, you know, this whole cycle of high production and, you know, the distress at the same time of the farmers, how do you look at this in this past year? Do you think anything has changed?
Things have changed. As you rightly put it in your prefatory statement, Mr. Nikam, that agriculture production has been consistently rising, and from a mere 51 million tons in 1951, reaching around 270 million tons. And being an export country, even in matters of food grains, is not a mean achievement. So things have changed, and in the right direction in this respect at least. Even in matter of diversification, like production of eggs, fish, horticultural produce, and particularly milk, we are now top producers of the world for several years.
Right.
So these are all positive dimensions, positive movements. But there have been certain negative aspects, like 60% of India's agriculture yet is rain-fed, where productivity is historically stuck up at 1.1 tons per hectare,
right,
against average of 4 tons in the irrigated areas of Punjab, Haryana, West UP, and so on. So that is the gap, and that is a matter of worry as well as it provides hope, because if we can fill up this gap, and if that can be done by developing water resources for irrigation, we can reach well beyond 400 million tons of production in a span of 5 to 10 years. But one major difference, a note of difference which I have to strike with you, Mr. Nikam, is in your statement that number of cultivators has come down, which is not correct. Number of cultivators has been going up, and that is a matter of worry, because the burden on agriculture land has been consistently increasing, and by now more than 80% of India's holdings are marginal, small and small medium, which are not economically viable. And it has its own economic and social implications, so that is the major cause of worry. And then the terms of trade and depleting soil fertility, mining of micronutrients like zinc, boron, molybdenum, sulfur, and so on, because of the over-chemicalization and toxicity of food. These are the matters of worry.
Okay. Dr. Panwar, filling up the gap, Mr. Sompal is talking of filling up the gap. In this previous, since we are looking at this year, which has gone by, you think that, you know, now that governments have changed, do you see any policy change, major significant policy changes happening?
I don't think so. They have several programs, but that are of the tokenism nature. They have announced that water for every field, and then 50% profit on the input prices, but nothing is translated at the ground. So my main worry, as Sompalji rightly said, that we achieved heights in the agriculture production, but this production is not benefiting to the farmer. That the farmers are at the rather last chain of this farm income.
Right. Why? Why do you think? I mean, this is a paradox that, you know, the production has gone up, actually, farmers have not benefited. The consumers have benefited at least?
Consumers are benefited.
Have benefited.
Yeah, because if you see the today paper, then the food inflation is at the minimum nowadays.
Absolutely.
So this entire pressure is translated to the farmer, because The businessmen never shared their profit with the farmers, but shared this to the farmer at every time and any time.
Suman, you know, it is said that we have all these years we have been concentrating on, you know, increasing the production. Production has been the major target. Profit is not the target. You know, productivity is not the target. Would you agree with
but
that?
What about, no. It is, of course, it's not the target. Otherwise, the farmers would not be in the dire straits that they are. But even to say that production is increasing, if you've seen the report of not 2 days ago, for the first time in 5 years, agricultural growth is showing a decline. So it is not correct to say that we are scaling new heights every year in agriculture.
So this is a new thing because last year the agricultural production had reached.
Yeah, this year has not. I mean, the whole, apart from the terrible monsoon, but agricultural production is not on a curve up. It's on a curve down if you take it over a number of years. The other thing is that when you say our production is going up, there are certain areas in this country which have been the high production areas. The Indo-Gangetic Plain. So we have our surpluses coming from Punjab, Haryana, Western Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh. But there is an India beyond this. And production decline, production stagnation, and abandonment of farms is taking place in 60% that is not Punjab, Haryana, and Western Uttar Pradesh.
But Mr. Sompal says that the cultivators have increased, whereas the reports and surveys show that they have decreased.
Every cultivator wants to get the hell out of agriculture. But the point is that today, I think Mr. Sompal might be, he can defend himself, but I think Mr. Sompal might be addressing the fact that every family in every generation has a larger number of people who inherit the same amount of land and therefore cultivate the same amount of land. But I think
fragmentation of land has taken place.
Fragmentation of land, I don't think is such a challenge because after all, there are countries that have farmed very small pieces of land very, very productively, Israel being an example, Japan, Korea, etc. We don't adapt to the fragmentation. We have not developed technologies for smaller land holdings. Your tractors are still gigantic mammoths. So if you adapt to the situation or you have policy to consolidate that land holding, but you have to react to the situation. Agriculture is nobody's baby. You're not reacting to the fragmentation. You're not reacting to the feminization. When all the men run away to the cities, the women are doing the agriculture and yet there is no machine that they can use because all the machines are made for men.
Ah.
So if you see how we are responding to agriculture, it's not just only that credit is not being increased, insurance cover is not being obtained. You are not adapting either equipment or methodologies or any production process to the reality of feminization, to the reality of fragmentation. And I think one of the greatest worries in agriculture today, which is going to come back and bite us fiercer and fiercer every year, is lack of investment in the appropriate research.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
To tackle the problems that we will face with climate change, with other kind of pressures on agriculture, we are simply not responding to that challenge. It's same old, same old, same old.
Dr. Tajamul Haq, what is your view on this? No, I want you to look at this year and significant any. I asked the same question to Dr. Sudhir Panwar. Significant policy changes?
I think in agriculture sector, all through have seen, it suffers from some problem or the other. Production, no doubt, normally has an upward trend, excepting in those years.
But you agree with Suman that the curve is now going down?
This year, of course, but then food grain production normally has shown an upward trend on the whole. But still, it is much less as compared to what it could be. The potentials are much more than what has been realized. Like in a country like China, for instance, if you see, their total area under crops or even under food grains is much less as compared to India. But their food grain production is several times higher. So what I'm saying that currently there is a huge gap. First of all, the yield gaps, both in the irrigated and unirrigated areas.
That Mr. Sompal was talking, yes.
But then that can be addressed again through some kind of policy changes and increased investment in irrigation and watershed development. The present government particularly, I can say, I don't know what they are going to do. But at least in the discussion that we find, they are that quite keen to increase the investment in irrigation and watershed development. This year, in fact, last year...
Why has it not happened adequately in the past? What is
in the past priorities, it is a question of how you fix the priority. Agriculture has always been neglected by no matter whatever government has come. In general, that is the kind of observation that I have. And so far as the farmers leaving agriculture and then farmers coming down in number, That is one thing what I say, that in this country, farming is not a profitable kind of occupation career as on today. And unless you make it profitable, there will always be an incentive for the farmers to get out of agriculture. But again, if there are alternative off-farm and non-farm opportunities,
right.
If they don't have that, they don't go for this. And size of holding itself should not be a constraint, because in China, Japan, Korea, everywhere, size of holdings are very small.
Right.
But
so they have adapted to that?
Adapted to that, right. Because they have a good appropriate technology that they need. They also have, you know, the kind of price incentive that they need. In Japan, for instance, if you see the relations between fertilizer prices and the rice prices, I mean, several times higher than what you have in India.
Absolutely.
So everywhere, there should be a system, an integrated support system. Technology support, price support, marketing support. Marketing is a huge problem, because farmers don't have even the incentives to grow what they are growing. Currently,
it is, Mr. Sompal, the question is that, you know, the change, what kind of changes would you like to see in the government's policies? You know, the broad general ones, more investment in irrigation, more investment in, you know, storage and things like that are fine. But any specific issues which you think the present government has taken up and would like it to take up further?
You see, you have in a way preempted me, Mr. Nikam, in saying that investment in agriculture is badly needed. If you have a look at the historical graph of investment, especially the public investment in agriculture, it has never been more than 0.3% of national GDP. And even within the planned outlays, it has never crossed 5%, and currently it reels well below 3% of all the allocations made under the plan head. A profession which sustains about 2/3 of India's population, offers employment to 54% of its workforce, contributes 12 to 13% to exports, produces all critical food, nutrition, and raw material for India, is getting only 1.3% of national GDP as investment, is not a very inspiring scenario. So first change that has to be effected is that, commensurate with its contribution and sustaining the people and employment, agriculture should be invested in a huge way, particularly in irrigation, to tap the yield gap that I had explained. The second issue, which relates to the number of cultivators and, as I said, the burden on land, because 83% of holdings of India have become economically unviable units, there is a very strong case of job generation within the rural areas for providing supplementary jobs to the people, and secondly, to shift people from agriculture to non-agriculture jobs within the rural areas, because the urban habitat is also burgeoning beyond scenes and beyond sustainability.
Okay.
So these are the two things. And then marketing, as rightly observed by Professor Huck,
yes,
is in shambles, and it is a carryover and continuation, unfortunately, of the old colonial policy of keeping all agricultural prices suppressed. And whenever the benefit accrues, it accrues to the middleman. Farmer does not get that benefit either out of export or rising prices and shortages. Therefore, marketing system has to be completely overhauled, and farmer under the present circumstances is having bad of both, of the shortages as well as abundance. Whenever he produces more, then the price is dip. If
okay.
he produces less, he has nothing to reprice.
Okay.
So this gap between the prices realized by the farmers and those paid by the consumers have to be put in within the bank. This I propose to Dr. Manmohan Singh also, that we adopt a price policy, and
okay,
that will benefit the farmers and consumers both.
Okay, sir.
So these are two things which are to be done, and they are already overdue.
Okay, sir. I think we need to go into a very short break now. Please keep watching. We'll come back very soon and continue this very interesting discussion. Welcome back. We are discussing the Indian agricultural scenario in the context of what has happened during the year 2014. Gargi, coming back to you. Gargi, the question is this, that the governments, the respective successive governments, as all my panelists have been talking about, have not been able to, find solutions to many of the problems of agriculture. There has been a consistently almost every successive government that Tajamul Haq says has been neglecting. How is it possible that governments neglect agriculture when it is actually their major vote bank?
Because farmers have no voice, they have no lobby, they are not kind of united. They don't have that kind of a lobby that, for instance, industry has or the big corporates have or other groups of people have in this country. Farmers themselves are divided. And whereas agriculture has sustained the economy when everything else was failing. If you remember, in the last to last year when there was a global crisis and when everything else was failing, then it was agriculture which progressed, which had a growth rate of almost 4%, and it sustained the economy. India being still self-dependent on agriculture.
And so the change, now we are in this year, we have seen a change in government.
Yes.
The kind of priorities which were there earlier. See, every government we keep hearing having, on paper, their priorities seems to be fine. But what happens when during implementation? Where is the problem?
This government came to power grappling with the monsoon situation. The southwest monsoon was delayed. Sowing had not happened in many places. And even when the rains came, it was too late to really get back to sowing for farmers. And as we see that now, kharif production is likely to be less by about 10 million tons, which may not be that bad. We will be able to sustain because, in wheat and rice, we are already surplus in stocks. And in oilseeds and pulses, we perpetually have a problem. That is the area which, and pulses, oilseeds, coarse grains, that is the area that needs to be addressed. Whether this government is going to pay attention to that area, we really don't know. What this government has started with is, there was a debate on agrarian crisis in parliament, and I sat through that debate, where what came through was that they want to start with looking at the soil of the farmers to see what kind of products they are using, whether they are overusing or they are underusing. So that they are starting from scratch, so to say. Other thing is that Pradhan Mantri Sichai Yojana, they have just going to launch, under which they want to make sure that water reaches every field. It's an ambitious project. It may be linked to the interlinking of rivers, which is also a long-term project. But the intention is there. And that is the crux of the problem. Sichai, getting water. To farmers in a country where 60% of farmers are dependent on rainfall, is really the starting point.
Okay. Dr. Parwar, the question is that, we know now what the problems have been. You think, what are the challenges before? Global prices have come down drastically, agricultural product prices. Where does India stand? And India has been one of the major exporters of food grains in the last year. The exports have gone up consistently. So how badly will the agriculture be hit because of the global price situation?
The main problem is this, that the domestic prices are aligned with the global prices.
Right.
And the farmers here in India are not competitive with the US farmers or any other developed country farmer, because they get huge subsidies there. This is an interesting case is the sugar cane here.
Right.
Farmers are subsidized by the UP government. They are providing rupees 20 per quintal. And the Karnataka government is also providing rupees 15 per quintal to sustain the agriculture of sugar cane. Because the input price is 253 rupees per the government estimates. And mills are paying rupees 240. So you can see the situation that farmers are losing 13 rupees per quintal on the sugar cane. So this year, I don't know what is the problem with the export of rice, but farmers are getting almost 50% less than what they got in the previous year. So onion prices are crashed by 59%. So farmers are not getting, I think it is the price signal which directly benefit farmers, and the price signal is missing. And what other, that earlier there was a subsidy on the diesel, now it is the
right, diesel prices have come down.
Right opportunity that government has withdrawn subsidy, but what happened with the crude prices again go upward.
Yes.
So these are the rather pragmatic shift in the agriculture sector.
Suman, one other thing is about soil fertility, one of the major issues as soil fertility. And then at the same time, this debate about introducing GM crops. where are we standing there? You know, this government has come out with a policy that, you know, GM crop trials should be held. So, you know, where are we now?
I think it's working against basic interests. Soil as the focus is spot on. That has to be the focus. Soil is the basis of food production, and soil is the basis of nutrition. Even if you produce food, if your soil is not good, you're not going to have nutrients. But I think if you look at the investments that the last budget has in barring irrigation, but everything is a 100 crore scheme. Now, that spate of 100 crore schemes is, as Dr. Panwar was saying, is nothing but tokenism. 100 crores today in a country like India means nothing. If you really want to invest...
No, but the government's argument is that it is just the beginning, it is just a token amount. We will be able to provide as much or whatever
wonderful,
is necessary.
Wonderful. That has to be greeted with great clapping of hands if soil and water are addressed. Because if soil and water are addressed, then I don't think this country will have a food problem. 60% and over
the challenges of when talking of food problem, food security, we need to sustain the production because, you know, to ensure that the Food Security Act provisions are fulfilled.
Well, hang the Food Security Act. If you allow farmers to produce, you don't need that act. The point is that your challenges is that of rain-fed agriculture. We have gone through several years of discussing this and nothing has happened. Rain-fed agriculture will be solved not just by the interlinking of rivers, it will have to be rainwater conservation, augmenting that whole older system we had of tanks and ponds.
If you don't do that,
you will not. On the question of GM crops, I mean, what are you going to do with a GM crop when there's no water? If in your 65% of India where there is in the rain-fed agriculture, which GM crop are you going to put in that is going to make you prosper? So it is a completely insane argument. The focus on soil and water is very welcome, is absolutely important. And the rubbish that is being done in the GM policy should be taken as something that is diversionary. I think part of it is also a perception question. Indian policymakers, Indian governments want to see the country as an industrial economy. So industrialists always have the government's ears, always have the government's purse strings. But let me just add one thing here for consideration of the people who are seeing this program. The largest industrial economies, like the United States, like the European Union, like Canada, these are the large, mega industrialized economies. These are also the most highly productive agricultural economies.
Absolutely.
They are agricultural producers of huge scale. They're agriculture exporters.
So it can't be.
You can't neglect agriculture and dream of being industrial. Absolutely. Will not happen.
Professor Panwar, very quickly about the GM crops issue.
GM crop, actually, what is the people have given mandate when Jairam Ramesh tried to introduce it? It is not necessary, as Suman Sahay said, that even when we cannot provide the irrigation for the 60% of the land, so there is no question of allowing GM crops.
So are you both saying that there is a mismatch of between the policies and the reality?
There's a mismatch between what the problems of Indian agriculture are and what you're trying to do with
what
GM
you are trying
crops.
To do with it. Professor Tajamul Haq, would you agree with that? Is that the problem? And now when you're talking of, you know, making Indian agriculture more profit oriented instead of just production oriented, how do we go about it?
Right in the beginning itself, I said that our policies have always been, you know, anti-farmers. Why I'm saying this, just see, when India was in a position...
You were the chairman of the Commission on Agricultural
CACB.
Costs and
yes.
Prices, and you were saying that...
No, why I'm saying this, because if you see all through, I used to tell the government even then, like when we had a surplus production of sugar, there was a ban on sugar export. When the international prices were higher than Indian prices. This was the policy followed by the earlier government, at least. Then also, when the export prices, I mean international prices of rice and wheat were high, I think we are holding on rice and wheat and we will not give it to anybody. There is a ban. For 3 years, there was a ban. So this is the kind of policy, because whenever there is something which can benefit the farmers, they will not do it. This is one. Second thing is, three important things I think I must mention before
we close.
Very critical things. One is, of course, irrigation and watershed development, as I said, this is the key. And the present government, I am sure, they will increase the investment this year. It will not be just 1,000 crores under PM kind of irrigation scheme. It will be...
It'll have to go up with several times.
Several times, 50,000 crore or maybe even beyond 1 lakh crore. So
that is the kind of investment which are necessary.
Necessary-wise, I think it is much more because...
but also
even
soil.
Just, it is even just for... You're completing the incomplete irrigation projects, you need more than that.
Right.
So that is one thing. But secondly, even this year's budget, in 1 year you will not be able to do it. There will be some time. But it, at least if you increase substantially, give a signal, and then there will be some impact. So I think that will be a very good beginning. Second thing, in the case of soil, restoration of soil health, already the present government has indicated that they are going to increase investment under that mobile soil testing facilities and, your soil health card kind of thing to be given to each farmer. Once they are successful in doing that, that will substantially reduce the cost of production because farmers will not arbitrarily, put urea in where phosphates is needed, and they will not go for MOP when phosphates is needed. So there, farmers will know what is needed in their plots to be applied, and that way they will rationalize the input use. The input cost itself will come down. Third thing is, this government is going to do, I'm sure at least the policy-wise they are saying, how much they are successful, that is again a question of implementation, organic farming. Will get a big thrust in the present government.
Okay.
So at least if these are, and then fourth thing is, skill development they are talking. If they also include this in the villages, because currently the rural farm youth are not interested in traditional farming, and that is not good for them. Also, they need to be trained in high tech agriculture,
okay.
Value addition processing.
Okay. Very quickly,
and
sir.
For that investment support
Mr.
and Sompal, policy. Support.
Mr. Sompal, we're running out of time. Very quickly, your solutions.
You see, it cannot be a single sentence solution, Mr. Nikam. It has to be a slew of measures.
Yes.
Including huge investment in.
No, whatever has been said by other people, if you leave that and if you have any specific solution.
You see, I would just supplement them. I am in gross agreement with all the distinguished panelists that the price is the most important signal. And therefore the marketing system has to be completely overhauled, huge investment in irrigation, and then also looking after fertility, because mere announcements do not help. There has been a big gap between the word and the action.
Okay.
And agriculture has been receiving a lot of lip service rather than concrete investment and
okay,
improvement
sir.
In the
okay.
system.
Okay, sir. Gargi, very quickly, last words to you. Do you expect this government to take up some of the solutions or recommendations or suggestions which our panels have given? Do you see that kind of a resolve in this government?
It has yet to come. The resolve is yet to come. As of now, I think they are still grappling with what is to be done. And as I said, they have made some start. But, on the price front, I feel that whenever prices fall below MSP, there has to be market intervention, for
right.
which the government has said that it will have a price stabilization fund will be activated, though we have not seen any movement there. So that is one area that really needs to be. And this government had promised 50% hike over and above the input costs, which the opposition is pushing this government towards.
Yes.
But we have seen that, a lot of MSP is already near 50% or something. So there also we have to see what is the baseline and what is the timeline that the government is setting. You can't expect the government to raise MSP in the first year. The previous government raised MSP because it was in an election year.
Right.
And also because so many other things were happening. China was taking a lot of cotton, so cotton prices went
okay.
up. There's a whole lot of things that happened,
Okay.
We are yet to see, even in GM crops, I feel the government is in two minds because it has some outfits which are saying that don't go for GM. Whereas the government itself has taken a position to go for GM. So, it has to play out. We have yet to see what the government wants to do.
We'll have to see how it will play out. Okay, I think on that note, we need to end. We'll have to see how it will all play out. A new government is in place. It has given some right signals, as some of my panelists feel, but we'll have to wait and watch. The year which has gone by has not been as good for agriculture as it has been in the for some years in the past. We'll wait and watch how it will be in the coming year. Thanks to all my guests, Mr. Sompal, who joined us from Chandigarh, Dr. Sudhir Panwar, Suman Sahai, Tajamul Haq and Gargi Parsai. Please keep watching. We'll come back with more issues about the year which has gone by on this program. Thank you very much.